Claire, as Didi said, I work in the linguistics department at Yale, and you might be wondering what it is that linguists do, because of course linguistics is not the sort of subject that that we learn about in the popular media all that much. It's not a high school subject or an elementary school subject. You know, it's not like mathematics or English or things like that. So linguists tend to be assumed to be people who speak a lot of languages, or they're people who do translation, or people who correct other people's grammar and things like that. For the sort of work that I do, and for the sort of work that we might want to think about for using language as a way to study the past, some of that is sort of true. So the sort of work I do involves a lot of different languages. It involves a certain amount of translation.
Linguistics isn't the sort of thing we hear about that much in high school for high school subjects and things like that. But linguistics nonetheless does occasionally make it into popular culture. For example, with the Arrival movie, one of the lead figures was a linguist, and she was tasked with saving the world and translating and deciphering and decoding the language of the alien arrivers, and that sort of thing is actually a lot closer to the sort of work that that I do and some types of linguists do. So it's not working on alien languages, but it's working on languages that might be quite different from the languages that we're familiar with from, say, high school French classes or hearing Spanish in the community and so on and so forth. I work mostly with Aboriginal Australian languages. I'm from Australia originally, as you can probably hear from my accent, although I've been in the US for nearly 20 years now. But still, a lot of my work involves working with speakers of Aboriginal languages, describing those languages, trying to figure out what sort of structures of those languages are the same as the languages we might be more familiar with, and what's different, and how those languages are related to one another, and what we can tell from those patterns of language relationship about the history of Aboriginal peoples. Okay, so that's the sort of thing I want to talk about today. I'm not specifically going to take a lot of examples from Australia. I thought I'd take examples from that might be a little bit more familiar, and I'm also going to talk pretty generally about linguistics in general. I'm very happy to take questions throughout the talk, so if I say something that that you'd like more clarification on or more examples for, then I'm very happy to take questions throughout and also at the end, of course, as well. I came to linguistics through classics. I was an undergraduate in first of all classics and then linguistics at the Australian National University. And so, of course, with classics, we've got many hundreds of years, thousands of years of very smart people saying things about the languages of that we associate with the classical world. And so that sort of work, very close reading of language and comparing languages that we know very well, figuring out what sort of problems there might be with the sources and the transmission of those languages. So, for example, the way that we get information from texts, papyrus. Papyri, for example, that sort of work has also very much transferred into my work with Australian languages, which has a very short descriptive tradition. So no Australian language was written before the 19th century. We have a lot of languages there that that aren't very well documented and aren't very well known. Okay, so let's take a step back from a step away, perhaps from Australian languages, and think about just in general terms the sources of evidence we have for the past. So, of course, we have our own memories, the things that we've witnessed for recent past that we've experienced ourselves. We've got television, the internet, the written record, newspapers, and so on for things that we haven't directly experienced. further back before, you know, before the internet, and so on. We have the written record. The written record goes back five thousand years or so in the longest traditions. So for the areas of the world where we have long written records, we can make use of that sort of information to figure out what has happened. So for example, for the history of English, we have documents from 1,000 years ago, which tell us where people were, what they were, where people were living, what they were doing, who they were fighting, what they were eating, how they were building their houses, what sort of things they were interested in, what sort of things they were arguing about, and so on and so forth. But for the most part, the written record is very incomplete. So it's very incomplete in world terms. Most languages are not written and have never been written. It's incomplete in terms of the time period. So, you know, 2,000 years seems like a really long time, but it's, a 50th of the time that humans have been speaking. Language is about 100,000 years old. So 2,000 years in one space is a very small amount of information. And of course, the sorts of things that people write down and the sorts of things that people get preserved is very, very small as well. It's a very small part of the language. Even for Old English, which has a pretty large corpus, there are basic words that we don't know how to say because we don't happen to have them preserved in those materials. So the written record is great when we have it, but for the most part, we don't have those sort of materials. We might think the archaeological record is good as well. So, of course, that gives us information about the sorts of houses that people were living in, the sorts of burial complexes they were making, whether they had coins, what sort of trade they did, what they were eating, and so on and so forth. But again, the archaeological record is pretty patchy. It's in some ways better than the written record, but it's also quite patchy. So, for example, for Aboriginal Australia, Australia has a lot of sand. Sand is not a good preservation medium for a lot of the things that that Aboriginal people were using to build with. Wood does not preserve very well, particularly in areas that have a wetter climate. So in Tasmania, for example, we know that people have been there for 30 to 40,000 years, but most of the archaeological record we have there is bone tools, and charcoal from paintings and things like that. So we know very little about the material culture of Tasmanians, in part because the sorts of things they were making were made with wood, which is not preserved very well in that environment. So archaeology helps us in some cases, but not in others. Of course, also the archaeological record will give us objects, but it also does not tie those objects to particular cultures. That's something that we have to do through analysis. And so in some cases that might be easy to do, because, for example, the archaeological record might contain language, or it might contain the overt record of the types of the people who were there. But in other cases, we might not be able to make those connections. So, for example, one of the big debates in Indo-European studies for the history of European languages and Indo-European languages was how to tie the languages to the particular cultures that we have archaeological information for. We might think that genetics is also a good source of information about the past. So we can do a huge amount with genetics these days. We can trace the spread of humans across the world 120,000 years ago. It's great for that, but it's not that great for more detailed, more recent past, particularly the last, couple of thousand years for languages like, for cultures and areas, again, like Australia or like South America, where we just don't have that sort of information these days. So language is an integral part of figuring out about the past. We can do a huge amount of work, a huge amount of inference about where cultures came from, who they've been interacting with, what were the features of their cultures, what sort of material culture they had, what sort of things they ate, and so on and so forth, just from looking at the words words that they use today, and thinking about where those words came from, thinking about where the where those languages' closest relatives are, and what words have been borrowed from other languages. And so this is the sort of thing I'm going to spend most of the rest of the time talking about. I just want to give you some examples about how we can use language as a way to figure out what has been going on, particularly in the last 5 to 10,000 years on Earth. Okay, so I thought I would start that by thinking about the global distribution of languages. So if I can find the pointer. It turns out that there are actually no very good maps of the languages of the world. I spent most of the week trying to find one that showed everything I wanted to show, and I couldn't find one. So instead we've got a couple of different ones. But it also turns out that my explaining why these are bad language maps will also be instructive for why this is an interesting question. So we'll go with the poor language maps. So this is a somewhat contemporaneous map of contemporary language use. We can see in America, for example, they've coloured America and most of Canada with this red colour, which is similar to the UK and also to parts of Western Europe and also Australia and New Zealand and South Africa. So this is the Germanic subgroup of Indo-European. These are languages that are pretty closely related to each other: English, German, Dutch, Swedish, Norwegian, Danish, Faroese, Afrikaans in South Africa. And so these are languages that that have diverged from each other pretty in the fairly recent past, within the last couple of thousand years. Okay, so we can see that, and again, this is a contemporary language map, because 200 years ago there was no English in Australia. 500 years ago there was no English in North America. But nonetheless, it's also, of course, overlooking a lot of linguistic diversity, because America doesn't only speak English, right? There are 500 or 600 languages spoken, probably more than that, close to 1,000 languages spoken in America. In not only Native American languages, but also immigrant diaspora languages as well. There's something like 400 languages represented in New York City, for example. So the creators of this map are choosing to gloss over that. The blue here is Romance languages, so French in Quebec, Spanish in Mexico and Cuba, Portuguese in Brazil, Spanish in other parts, Spanish and Portuguese in South America, and also Spanish, French, Italian, and Romanian in Europe. Okay, so we're seeing, so these languages are also pretty closely related to one another. They all descend from Latin. We know when Latin was spoken because we have lots of records of Latin. And in fact, we'll see some more comparative work with Romance a little later in this talk. So we see a fairly large part of the New World and Europe represented by that. Yeah.
How do you determine when dialect becomes its own language, in a language?
Right. Yeah. So that's a really good question. How do we tell the difference between a dialect and a language, and how do we know when a dialect has become a language? So you can often say that we can tell the obvious cases when two languages are languages and not dialects. We can tell the obvious cases when dialects are a dialect, but there are a number of in between cases. Paula.
Can you just define dialect?
Dialect is two varieties. We'll call them two people speaking something are speaking dialects of the same language if they can understand each other, broadly.
Like a nuance?
So nuance is mostly meaning, whereas dialect could be accents, or they could be word choices. So if I call it the boot of my car rather than the trunk, or if I'm putting on a jumper rather than a sweater, if I talk about my car rather than my car, those sorts of things. So some of those are accent things, and some of those are different words. Or if I say something like my car needs washed, then you know that's a grammatical difference that's associated with a particular dialect. So all of these things are dialectal differences. But even if I say car rather than car, you know what I'm talking about, right? So it's not stopping us from understanding each other. Or if I said brother rather than brother, then you know what word I'm using. But if I used a word like umbambola, then that's the Bharati word for brother. Totally different word, totally different language. And so if I started speaking Bharati, it would be really clear that I was speaking a different language, not a dialect of English. So for those really clear cases, we can say, okay, these are two separate languages. Speakers can't understand each other. These are dialects of the same language. They're not the same. They're not speaking like exactly the same way, but speakers can still understand each other when they're talking. And then there are these middle ground cases where, for example, Spanish and Portuguese Portuguese speakers can usually understand Spanish speakers, but not vice versa. Or Norwegian and Swedish, the more familiar the speakers are with the other variety, the easier it is to understand. There's a lot of words in common, but they're still somewhat different, and you know they're associated with different countries. So they have nation state polities behind them that make us more likely to identify them as different languages. So there's a political element to the definition of dialect and language as well. So there are tricky cases like that too. Yeah.
Can you identify the red on the northwest side of South America?
Oh, this, yeah. That's a Dutch Creole. So Creole language that has its roots in Dutch. Or actually, it might be Guyanese Creole. But both of those would be coloured red in this. In this scheme of the map. So there's an English-based Creole and there's a Dutch-based Creole as well. So they're grouping those with those languages with.
And that would be where in national?
In Guyana.
Yeah.
And the Dutch Creole, I can't remember off the top of my head, but I can look it up for you.
But in Africa, there's two areas that are the same color as eastern coast of China.
This area and this. So I think those are just. The map is hard to read. Oh, so this is. These are Afroasiatic languages. Somali and Tigrinya and so on. So they're actually ultimately related to Arabic, but they've been given a different color. These are Khoisan languages, click languages. So they're recycling colors here. So these languages are not related to Chinese.
That goes to the point you said it's not the best.
Right. Yep.
Oh, okay.
Yep. Right. Yeah. And one other thing about this map that. Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Where do you put Creole in this? Is it a dialect? Is it a language? So
Creole is a type of language. There are lots of Creoles. There are, I think, about 70 or 80 Creoles we know about. Some are based on English. Some are based on Dutch, French, Spanish, or Portuguese, and Arabic, Arabic and Russian, as well. And so Creoles are usually defined by how they were created, rather than by what language they're most closely related to. So they're associated with particularly with the slave trade or with large numbers of originally second language learners who then pass that on to their kids. But they fall into a number of different language families. So one other thing I wanted to say about this map before we go on is that the way they have chosen to color this map is somewhat Eurocentric or Indo-European centric. So we saw that English and German and Scandinavian languages got the same colors, and Romance languages got the same colors. But Romance languages and Germanic languages are pretty closely related to each other. We can show that they go back to a common ancestor language, a proto language as it's called, from within the last 7,000 years. Whereas these languages here in Australia, this red is English, but these are Aboriginal languages that belong to 28 different families that can't be shown to be related to one another, and yet they all receive the same colour. Likewise, in South America, this light colour, there's at least 15 families here that can't be shown to be related to one another, yet they all receive the same colour. So that's one of the reasons I found this map a little, why I would like to find a better map, but that was the best we could do for this. I'd like to move on, and so this is the some estimation of the distribution of language diversity in the world, and because of the way this map is coloured, it's somewhat difficult to see. We're going to see a map of Native North America in a little while, and we're going to do some detective work for trying to look at the distributions of language patterns to see how they might see what we might be able to tell about language relationships and language spread. But first of all, I just wanted to show you this map to show you that the distribution of speakers of languages are not equally distributed around the world. So this is a map of countries, and it's skewed by the number of different languages in the country. So you can see that some areas are squashed and some languages are expanded. So Papua New Guinea, for example, just north of Australia, has something like 1,000 languages, 1,000 autochthonous languages, so 1,000 languages that diversified there. Yet it has a population of about 3 million people. Conversely, Chile has a large landmass, but relatively few languages represented these days. Okay, so you can see that there are disproportionate language diversity and language density is not the same from country to country, and as it turns out that language density is somewhat related to population density, but not fully. But there are more languages the closer you get to the equator. So there's some relationship there. You know, there are also more people the closer you get to the equator, because it's easier to live closer to the equator than it is in the Arctic or the Antarctic. So we have to always take into account geography and ecology and so on. We linguists tend to treat languages as being isolated from the populations that speak them. So we think about languages on their own terms and what are the properties of languages and so on. But of course, languages are spoken by people, language distribution and language transmission and so on is very much a function of what people do, how they speak, who they speak to, and so on and so forth. I wanted to. Oh, this is totally. Yeah, that might. Yeah, if it doesn't show, I can still actually make my main point with this, because you can see California, but there's, I wonder if I can change the, let me very quickly see if I can change the color preferences. This is gonna, okay, that's, let me not spend any time figuring out there. I will describe here. So this is a map of North America, as you can see. You can see what you can't see is that there's a couple of families here. There's Algonquian languages that go right down the eastern seaboard and across northern Canada. There are Siouan languages, Iroquoian languages, and Athabascan languages. With actually, you can see Athabascan here and here. Another thing you can see is that the distribution of languages in across the U.S. Is quite uneven. So one of the things that did come out is the big diversity of different languages in California and Oregon. So basically, west of the Sierras, there are a lot more languages than there are in the area immediately east of the Sierras. And so questions like that are interesting to ponder for linguists and anthropologists. So why is it that there are so many more languages in California than there are, say, in Ohio or in the Plains region? I should mention that this is a historical map. This is best guess as to traditional locations of Native American groups at around the time of European settlement. So, of course, European settlement is the dates of European settlement are quite different in different parts of America. So, a couple of hundred years earlier for Connecticut and the New England region, and for Florida than they are for the West. So, that of course might be one reason we see more languages in the West Coast. Our guesses as to who was how many languages were spoken there are better for areas that were settled more recently. Or, of course, this could be an actual fact about language distribution. One thing we know is that language split, so creations of multiple languages from one language, happens in cases where different groups of people lose contact with one another. So areas where travel is easier and where it's easier to maintain links of communication and so on, we would expect to find fewer languages. So, for example, the Great Plains versus the Sierras would be a good example of that. So, rugged areas, mountainous areas, tend to have a lot more languages than relatively flat areas. And we see that in the Caucasus. We see that in South America, in the Andes. We see it. We don't really see it in Australia because Australia doesn't have those really big mountain ranges. But we see it in Africa, and so on. We see it in the Himalayas. We see it repeated over and over. So this shows us that language is a language split and accrual of language diversity is in part a function of geography. Another difference between language or why we might expect to find more languages in some places than others is something I mentioned before about population density. So, if the terrain is can support more people, then people have to travel less far in order to get food. And so you would have more people in a region, and you might expect more people to be talking less or having to communicate less with people from very far flung areas. And so you would expect that. All else being equal, to lead to more languages over time as well. Speaking of more languages over time, time is another important feature of language accrual. So areas that have been settled more recently, we might expect to have fewer languages just because there hasn't been enough time for language language split to take place. Languages change; everything's changing all the time. So all languages change all the time. But at the same time, language change is not so fast that members of different generations can't understand one another. So that puts an upper bound on the amount of change we can see at any particular time. Okay, so we expect, all else being equal, for areas that have been settled for a long period of time to have more languages in them, whereas areas that have settled very recently have fewer languages. And we can actually see this at the level of dialect as well. So if you think about dialect diversity in America, there are a lot more English dialects in New England and the East, and areas that were settled more that were settled earlier than in the West. And in the center. So we see this in miniature as well as at the language level. Okay, so languages change. They change all the time. They change slowly. We can use the distribution of languages to make guesses about where people came from, we can also, so that's at the level of language and the level of language distribution. We can also study the actual changes in languages and the similarities that they have and the ways that languages correspond to one another, and we can use that in order to undo the changes that have occurred and figure out what language might have looked like a couple of thousand years ago, or five, or even about 10,000 years ago. Beyond about 10,000 years, the number of changes is so great that we basically lose all signal. We lose all the evidence that we might want, we might have to reconstruct those changes, because at that point everything's changed, so it doesn't look as regular as we might want to have it look. So I want to give you a quick example of this from some Romance languages. So I've given you some words from Portuguese, Spanish, Catalan, and French. These are not in the alphabets in the writing systems that these languages typically use. So if you know French, or if you know Portuguese or Spanish, you'll see these words are not spelt the way you would expect. Instead, they're spelt in a standard alphabet that lets us say that the same sound is written by the same letter each time. So for example, in Spanish this would be spelt with a C, but C is pronounced in different ways in different words. So here we spell it with a K to signal that this is a K sound that is also the same as the K in Portuguese and Catalan and French. Okay, so if we look at these words, we can see that there are similarities, as we might expect. So so contra in Spanish, contra in Catalan, contra in French, and contra in Portuguese. We have saco, saco, sac, and sac for bag, which is the English word sack. It's a borrowing, it's a loan word from French. We have for beard, we have barba, barba, barbe, barb, and so on and so forth. So we see that these words are pretty similar. So in a couple of thousand years of change, these core vocabulary words haven't actually changed all that much. But we can also see that there have been changes. But the changes we can also see are regular. So for example, where Spanish has an N plus a sound like T or D or G, Portuguese has a nasal vowel. So Spanish has contra, but Spanish has this en sound, okay, contra, and French has this as well. So we see this not only in the word against, but we also see it in the word big, so grande, but grandi and grand in French. We see it in blood as well, so sangui, sangre, sang, and in the word for five, cinco. Okay, so this is an example of a regular sound change, and it turns out that most sound change, pretty much all sound change, is regular in language. When there's a change, it's not like one word, one sound in one word will change, but all of those sounds all of the relevant sound will change in all words, and that means that that's powerful evidence for us to figure out from the correspondences, from the ways that words relate to one another, what they must have look like back before those changes took place. So, Deepti, yeah.
And can you tell if you saw something like this, would you be able to tell which is the parent of
which is the progeny then?
So in this, so for some sound changes, we know that they only go in one direction. So the case of the nasal, the N sounds and the nasal vowels, so en versus on, we know that the only source of en vowels is a vowel plus an N type sound. So if we see one and the other, we know that it started as an on or as an, and changed to en or a, and not the other direction. In other cases, we might not be able to tell. Another change where we have the where we know the direction of the change is the S to th. So this this theta is so S to th is a lot more common than th to s. So we would say we would probably want to say that the ancestor sound was an S and S became th in Spanish. Also in this case we would probably want to use majority, the evidence of the number of languages that have a particular sound. So in this case, S, we find S in Portuguese, in Catalan, and in French, whereas we only have the th in Spanish. If we assume that S became th, then we only have to, we have to assume that that happened once, just once in the history of these languages. Whereas if we assume that th became s, it may well have had to have happened like three independent times. And linguistics, like biology, uses principles of parsimony and Occam's razor to suggest that changes are, if you composite the same evidence with fewer changes, then that's a metric that we should, a piece of evidence that we should take into account.
In Portuguese, the words, there's fewer letters. I know it's phonetic what you've done, but mm-hmm. does a smaller word indicate an older language?
Not necessarily, because there are many ways that languages can get shorter words. So not all sound changes are deletions. So in the case of the nasal, the vowel plus N becoming an O, becoming a nasal vowel, that's a shortening of the word. That's a combination of two sounds into one. But we have other changes where either there are the same number of sounds or you increase the number of sounds. So, for example, the English word empty, so we spell it, spelling's not a good example there. In Old English, that word did not have a P in it. Okay, so we say empty, like with the P, but in Old English that P was not there, but that P has been inserted over time as a kind of a bridge between the M and the T. So that would be a case of words getting longer. Words also get longer when other words join to them. In the language I did my PhD on, Bardi from Northwest Australia, there was a change where pronouns like I and you and me and they and so on ended up being closely associated with the verb of the sentence. And so over time, so there were say 100-150 years ago, there were a certain number of pronouns that always occurred on the verb, and then in the last 20-30 years, even more of them became attached, so the words ended up becoming even longer than they had been from sources in the 1930s, for example. So these changes go in both directions. I think that's pretty much one other thing I wanted to say about sound change here. So in some cases we can tell the directions of the sound changes. In other cases we either can't from information like this, or we would have to use other information. So, for example, with the word for daughter, we've got filha, hija, filha, and filha, and we might be hard pressed on the basis of those words alone to work out exactly what the chain of sound changes was. We may be able to do it with that. But of course, when we're doing comparisons with languages, we're not just looking at 15 words or so. We're looking at whatever we have. For these words, this would be thousands and thousands of words. Another example for regular sound change is that all the Portuguese and Spanish words end in a vowel, whereas all the Catalan ones, apart from contra and barba, end in a consonant. Okay, so where we have copa and copa for cup, we've got cop in Catalan. Corte, corti, but cor in Catalan. And so we can see that a lot of final vowels have been lost. In fact, final syllables in some cases as well. Okay, so we can use the evidence from, so we can use these differences between languages to build up ideas about the sorts of changes that these languages have undergone, and we can use that to group the languages together. And linguists use family trees to do that. We use the same sort of representation that biologists use for species. In fact, there are a lot of parallels between languages and species in terms of how we can study their changes, how we can study, how we can do do reconstruction, and how we can figure out what has changed and what the properties of the families are as well. And so here's an example of a family tree of Indo-European, of the family that that English and German and Romance languages and also many other languages of Europe belong to. And so this is another way that we use language to work out aspects of the past. So we can build these family trees of relationships of languages and look at where they are, where those languages are currently spoken, and where in turn they must have been spoken in the past. All right, so to give a clearer example of that, this is Central Australia here. This is the Karnic subgroup of Parmenyungan, so it's a group of languages, Karnic, here, spoken in the Lake Eyre Basin. This is actually the lighter areas are rivers. This is the desert, so the rivers are dry. They only flood every couple of years. But you can see here, so you can see the family tree of these languages. The dots, pushpins here are the where the languages are, or where the languages used to be spoken. None of these languages are spoken anymore. Oh no, actually, Dieri still has speakers. Dieri has about 10 speakers, but none of the other languages have speakers. If we just plot these, plot the locations of the languages on the map, and we plot the family trees on the map, like I did here, you can see that the languages branch as they travel down the rivers, right? So, so for here and here, and this is the Bulu River. These are trees, but they're hard to see because there's not flowing water, but the water table is higher, so more trees grow around in this area. So you can see that there's four branches so this one only has two languages, but the speakers of these languages are presumably traveling down the rivers, and as they go, the groups are bifurcating. Okay, and that happens both here down this river, down Cooper Creek, down here, and down the Bulu River, and down the Diamantina as well. And so that's something that we would not see just from looking at the languages, or just looking at the languages on the map like that. That's something we get from looking at the relationships particularly. Okay, so with that, I thought I'd just wrap up briefly. Sorry? Yeah, sorry.
So in the previous slide, the previous slide, mm-hmm. The problem is not set up in biology, it's about genetic similarity of the two.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, what is this? Is it how are two languages displaying the standard of taking different?
We use a lot of different methods. We use distance methods as well as evolutionary methods. This was a Bayesian tree done from lexical evolution, lexical cognates. So looking at whether the words are shared, whether words for particular meanings in particular meaning classes are shared in each of these language groups, and then fitting an evolutionary model to that. So for example, say for words for hand, for each of the languages we would say, does the language have a word that's related to English hand? Is there a word related to English hand in this data? And we'd say yes for English, yes for German, no for French, no for Italian, and so on. Then we'd ask, does the language have a word related to manus, Latin manus? And we'd say yes for Spanish, yes for Italian, yes for French, no for English, no for Hindi, no for Norwegian, and so on. And so we build up these matrices of character sets of words of word relationships, and then we do phylogenetics on that, pretty much. Usually it's 200 words of basic vocabulary, so the words that are unlikely to be loaned, unlikely to have horizontal transfer from one language to another. So words like hand are not borrowed very often, but a word like cell phone or iPad would be a really bad word to choose for this, because because it's the same word in pretty much all these languages, but also because we know it's been recently introduced, and the word has been borrowed from one language to another pretty regularly, or frequently. So it tends to be words that we assume are stable and that are not borrowed very frequently. So from that there might be, depending on the language family, between 1 and 50 or more different cognate words. For the words for hand we were talking about, there's hand, there's manos, there's cher in Greek, there's ruka in Russian, and so on and so forth, a couple of others. But most of the languages of Europe would have one of those words. For Australian languages, if we do this for Australia, there's one word, mara, which covers most of the country, and then another 30 languages also have different words. I don't know offhand how many total cognate classes they had, so 200 words, but I'm not sure how many characters that expanded into. For the work I've done with Australian languages for this, we used 200 words, and we ended up with about 6,000 comparison sets based on the cognates shared by more than one language. Yeah?
Do they all have to be written in order to fit into that?
So that we have to have data for them, so someone has to have written down something at some point or recorded something at some point, even for these European languages, some of these languages were not written until the modern period. The point at which European languages have started to be written varies a lot from more than a couple of thousand years ago to the 19th century. Some of the forms in here are what we might call non-standard varieties, like dialects of French that are not usually written still these days. For the Australian languages, I've worked with, none of these languages were written before the mid 20th century for the most part. There's no for what we're working on here. We're working with written representations of spoken language. So for cultures that have literacy very highly embedded in them, writing assumes a very special place. But for linguists looking at the structures of language, writing's just a convenient way of representing spoken language. So it's always the spoken language that's key. Although I should say we can also do this sort of work on sign languages as well, but for this is a spoken language. Yeah.
I've never understood how we know what ancient languages sounded.
Oh, that's an awesome question. Sometimes we don't. Sometimes we don't really know what they sounded like. Usually what we do is we make our best guess based on what we think based on what we know about how the writing systems are used for languages that we do know something about. So for Latin, for example, we know what an A character sounds like in English and in German and in Italian and Spanish and all the other languages that use that system. And so we can be pretty sure it was something like an R. In other cases, we might not be so sure. So for example, with Latin's another good example for this, with the K sound, the C sound, there are different opinions about when the C started to be pronounced as a ch sound before certain consonants. So in the way I was taught Latin, a word of the form, say, A-C-I, would be pronounced A-C-I, but for someone who was more familiar with the Italian version of Latin, it would be A-C-I, right? Or the E-C-E, like E-C-C-E, like behold, would be E-C-E for the way I was taught, but E-C-E for someone who'd grown up with the more Italian version of Latin. We know at some point something like E-C-C-E was pronounced, came to be pronounced Ecce, because that's what it's how it's pronounced in Italian, but we don't know exactly when that happened, and we don't know very much about dialectal differences in Latin itself.
There would be no way of knowing if there had been, say, a great vowel shift at some point before these modern languages developed.
Right.
So the original Latin could have been pronounced one way, then there could have been a vowel shift, and then the modern languages.
It's possible, but standardized spelling is relatively recent. So in the Latin sources, for example, people tend to write the way they speak, and there is variation. So for example, in whether the final M of accusative case marking is written, that comes and goes in different sources. Graffiti in Pompeii is a really great source for this, because there's a lot of it, and especially more colloquial sources, and we have letters and so on as well. So in those cases, we can see what sort of things vary. We also know we have prescriptive works from grammarians who say people are speaking the wrong, that they're saying the wrong thing, and so that gives us information about what they were saying. So, you know, kids these days are dropping their H's everywhere, and Catullus makes fun of what's his name, Harrius, who you know, his name is Arius, but he puts H's in where they're not supposed to be in Latin, and leaves them out, and so on. So that's presumably some sort of sound change in progress. We also know those are some ways we can figure out what ancient languages sounded like. Those are probably the best ways to figure them out. In other cases, we use evidence from sounds that all languages have. So there's a lot of variety in the sound structures and sound systems of different languages in the world, but all languages have consonants and vowels. So we presume that, given that all 7,000 or so modern languages have both consonants and vowels, we assume that ancient languages did as well. And so that lets us figure out, we might not know exactly what vowel it is, but we say, okay, so the nucleus of the middle of a syllable is going to be a vowel of some sort. If we know that there are three of the, three different vowel type sounds, it's most likely that there's something like R, E, and U, because most of the languages that have only three vowels have those three vowels. Sometimes they have E, U, and R, so they have three different height of vowels, but there's no language that has, say, U, O, and U. So that would be very unlikely. So we can use those sort of guesses from plausibility from what we know about language structures more generally. So those are the two ways of figuring it out usually. Okay, just wanted to wrap up very briefly. I thought, what do I want you to know about of linguistics for, you know, given that I have an hour of your time to tell you about linguistics and language change, what sort of things do I want you to take away from this? So one is that there's a lot of linguistic diversity still in the world. Most of these languages are, about half of the world's languages are endangered to various degrees. about 90% of the world's linguistic diversity is represented by 10% of its population. So there's a big, as we saw from the map before, the world's language diversity is not equally distributed country by country. It's also not equally distributed across population. So there are an awful lot of languages with very small numbers of speakers. And the languages that we're most familiar with are actually pretty atypical for most of the languages in the world. And language is an important part of figuring out the past. It's not, of course, the only way, but in conjunction with archaeology and genetics and the written record, it can give us insight into areas of prehistory where we might not have archaeology, or we might not have genetic information, or we might not have the written record. And so with that, if you'd like to find out more about the sorts of things I do with linguistics and biological methods and language change and language documentation and so on, I have a website. I also have a lab website, parmenjungen.net, but you can get to it from that. And the National Science Foundation has funded my work over the last 10 years or so, so I'd like to acknowledge their funding support as well. And I'm happy to take questions. So.
Looking backwards at how language, would you care to speculate on how that informs your linguist's guess as to where things are going to be moving in the future?
Oh, yeah. There was a study that was released about 6 months ago, I think. It was called The Sounds of London in 50 Years, and it was exactly this sort of thing where it was an insurance company, actually, that paid some linguists to figure out what London English would most likely sound like in 50 years. It's very difficult to tell, so we can undo changes, but we can't predict which changes are going to occur at any given time. We know the sorts of things that are most likely to change. So, for example, we know in American English that the consonant systems are pretty stable, but the vowel systems are changing quite substantially. So, for example, there's a set of changes called the Northern City Shift in Chicago and Detroit and from Rochester, New York, west for quite a large part of the inland north, where the vowel I have as o is fronted a lot, so my sock, as in these things, are more like sacks rather than socks, and sacks, as in saku that we saw before, would be more like siak. So we get an a to ear, but o to a, and then there are other changes associated with that as well. And there's a similar set of vowel changes in the south called the Southern City Shift, which is, for example, where pin and pen are pronounced the same. So you might have heard say speakers from Georgia talking about so this would be a pin rather than a pen, so there are a number of changes like that. So I would expect to see those changes continue in American English over the next 50 years or so. So we spend a lot of time thinking about how the internet and television and so on is reducing dialectal diversity, but it may be doing so at the very local level, but we're still getting changes that are and sets of changes that are continuing that are making different regional varieties of American English more different from one another. And those aren't going anywhere. So I guess the main prediction would be that languages will continue to change, and the details will be as unknowable as they will be knowable in retrospect. But it's basically impossible to predict what's gonna go next. Yeah.
How far back in time can you go before somebody from one time period would understand the spoken word from somebody in another time period?
Oh, yeah.
And English spoken in the U.S. at the Revolutionary War time?
Mm-hmm. So, Yeah. So the question is, how far back can you go before? How far back can you go to have two people from different time periods understanding what each other is saying? It depends on the language. Languages change at different speeds. For English, for Shakespearean English, we have a reasonable idea for Shakespearean English about what it sounded like. It's reasonably easy for modern speakers to get most of that. Of course, there are words that that Shakespeare used that we don't use anymore. So that makes it difficult to for some parts of Shakespeare's plays to be understood, for example. But if we went to Chaucer, which is what another 200 years or so before Shakespeare, when we read Chaucer, we need the notes to follow what's going on. That's pretty different, but not totally opaque.
All of that from the word differences as mm-hmm. opposed to the pronunciation differences.
There's so much. Yeah, maybe English is not a good example of this because there's so much dialectal variation that there are speakers of even of modern American English varieties that can't understand each other.
Populations that are pretty stable. Chinese, for I think.
So Chinese has there are 20 or so different languages that come under the label Chinese. They're united by a single writing system, but with very different pronunciations. So, right. Greek would be an example. The writing system preserves the writing system preserves more information than say spoken modern Greek has undergone a number of sound changes that are not reflected in the writing system, somewhat like English, in that respect. So speakers of modern Greek can read ancient Greek with relatively little problem, but the words are pronounced quite differently. Italian and Latin would be a reasonable example. That's probably the best I can think of anything with a long history. Armenian, been written for 600-700 years with pretty similar systems, relatively little dialect diversity there. So that would be a goodish example. Yeah.
So considering that Ethiopia is sort of like the cradle of us, the language is Amare. Mm-hmm. Now, where else is that? When they went out, where is that? What happened to that language?
Oh, right, yeah. So Amharic is, I think it's Afroasiatic, so it's related ultimately to Semitic languages and to Berber languages and other languages of North Africa. But that would not be the, that language would have replaced the languages that that would have been there before. There's African linguistic diversity is relatively understudied. It's been assumed that there were only four families in Africa until fairly recently, but the most recent research suggests that some of those families have been lumped together that should not have been. Some of those languages have been assumed to be members of the same family, where we don't actually have the evidence for that. For the languages that we can do historical reconstruction that we have done historical reconstruction for, there's a ceiling of about 10,000 years on the family. So we have a large number of families where we can reconstruct to something that's between 5,000 and 10,000 years old. Austronesian, for example, which covers pretty much it covers Hawaiian, Indonesia, Taiwan, all the way to Madagascar, the Philippines, all the way to Madagascar. When we undo the changes and the reconstructions and plot the families and the changes on a map, we get Taiwan as the location there about 5,500 years ago. Indo-European is somewhere between 5,000 and 8,000 years, depending on who you talk to. Parmenyungan, the largest Australian family, is probably about 6,000 years. Afroasiatic is probably about 10,000 years, 10,000 years old. Turkic is about 3,000 to 4,000 years. Austroasiatic, which is another large family in Asia, is probably about 7,000 to 8,000 years old. So it seems like around sometime in the last, in the Holocene, in the early to mid Holocene, 5,000 to 10,000 years ago, there were a lot of language splits and a lot of population movement, probably associated with climate change and climate amelioration after the glaciers receded. So remember, before 9,000 years or so, a lot of North America was under ice. A lot of Eurasia was under ice and was not habitable. So as the glaciers receded, that produced that led to more land that was habitable and people moved into those areas. That of course doesn't answer your question about Africa, but it does explain why we have so much of our linguistic diversity seems to be relatively recent. It's probably also the case that these language expansions replaced earlier languages that were there, and we just have no record of them. They weren't written. They didn't leave traces in loan words. In Europe, we have Basque and Etruscan as two languages that were surrounded by Indo-European languages and were presumably there before Indo-European languages arrived, but we don't know anything more about who was there before that.
And another question: how does language correlate with music in terms of its spread?
My instinct is to say probably not that much. Musical styles are very easy to spread. It's relatively difficult to learn. It's relatively easy to learn a song. It's relatively difficult to learn a language. Musical styles, musical instruments, and so on can be picked up pretty easily. Whereas languages take a lot more learning. Both language and musical styles and other aspects of culture have both a horizontal and a vertical component to them. So they're both passed down through lineages, and they're passed between lineages from neighbor to neighbor as well. In language, we see this through loan words and occasionally through language shift. We see it a lot more with cultural features. So I would not expect to see much overlap between musical styles and language styles, although if I did see that, I would not be surprised, but if I didn't see it, I would also not be surprised.
Yeah. Do you have any connection between the Indians of the Americas and Asia?
I should repeat the question. Is there a connection between Native American groups in North and South America and with indigenous groups in Asia? So there's two sets of connections. So one is with the Yupik languages. Yupik is spoken both in Alaska and in Siberia. So there are speakers on both sides of the Bering Strait. That's probably pretty recent, but it's a connection nonetheless. And there are also older connections between the Yenisei languages spoken in northern Siberia, so a long, long way from the US, and the Athabascan languages. Navajo and Apache are probably the best known Athabascan languages, but there are a number of them in both Canada, Alaska, and in the Southwest as well, around the around Navajo and Apache and Hopi.
Okay, and how about North and South America?
North and South America is... There's been a claim that Chitimacha, which was spoken in Texas and Louisiana, is related to languages in Mexico. That's unproven. Uto-Aztecan would be the only very clear case. So Paiute in California, just east of the Sierras, and the southern Aztec, the languages of the Aztec. Aztecs and Nahuatl, I think, is included in that family too. So that's a very clear relationship. But further south, there's nothing that we've been able to see so far. But South America is an extremely interesting, extremely diverse area for languages. There's it's a patchwork quilt of relatedness. So just in contrast, so if you see with these are different subgroups in Australia, and they're all contiguous. So they're all blocks of closely related languages. These colours are just recycling colours. South America looks about as different from that as you can get. So you have languages that are. If I get back to my South American map. So there's a family called Arawak, for example, that has speakers here, and here, there are speakers of other unrelated languages in between. There's a Tucanoan family that has some languages here, and then some others here, so Eastern and Western Tucanoan. There's another family, Tupi Guarani, which has 10 different branches in 10 different places. And so on and so forth. So it looks like there's been a lot of population movement around there, and a lot of linguistic diversification. So just a lot of change, which makes it hard to undo that. Yeah.
Referring to the Native American tribes in the Southwest, how do you account for the Zuni? The Zuni language is not a Slavic language.
Right. Yes.
And they're surrounded totally by Athabascan, and more importantly, all of you as Hinton.
Mm-hmm. I can't give you a specific answer about Zuni, but there are a number of different ways that isolates form in general. There are I think about 300 isolates across the world where there are languages with no known relatives to no known relations to each other, they occur either because all the related languages have been replaced. In some cases, we know that there were language relatives that that are no longer spoken. In other cases, it could be that they split off from their neighboring, their most closely related other members of the family pretty a very long time ago, and then just didn't split further after that. So Greek, for example, in Indo-European, it's not an isolate, but it's the only member of its family, its closest relatives are not particularly closely related to it. Whereas if you compare, say, English has Dutch, Frisian, all the North Germanic languages, Gothic, and so on and so forth. So a lot of Proto-Germanic gave rise to a lot of languages, but Proto-Greek gave rise pretty much to only Greek. That's another way that we can get isolates. But in the case of Zuni, we don't know. Presumably, there were other languages spoken before Uto-Aztecan speakers came in, Athabascan speakers came in. Pueblo languages are also not closely, they're closely related to each other, but they're not closely related to anything else that we know of. So there are a number of areas of very high linguistic diversity in America. So California is one, Florida and the Louisiana coast is another, where we have a lot of language names where we have no information about what language family they belong to, sorry, I can't say more than that for that.
So thanks very much, Claire, again. And one thing I definitely learned from what you said, it's good to have people complain about these new things coming into language, because there's a record of
right.
What went on.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go there.